Thank you. It's an honor to be here tonight. On February 1st, 1960, four black college students sat down at a lunch counter at a Woolworths in Greensboro, North Carolina, and politely requested lunch. They were refused. When asked to leave, they quietly held their course. Their actions inspired a youth-led movement of civil disobedience centered on equal access to the spheres of public and commercial life. In the years that followed, sit-ins and Woolworths counters throughout the segregated South were staged. In this picture, from a sit-in in Jackson, Mississippi in 1963, you can see three students seated at the counter, covered in ketchup and sugar. A crowd of young white men, faces full of contempt, stand behind them. Today, the Woolworths counter, which is permanently placed on exhibit at the National Museum of American History, is enshrined in our collective memory of the power of the people and their struggle for freedom to end racial segregation. What is sometimes forgotten from the public record is that this was a movement of young people, students, centered on access to food service in a public setting. They demanded the common dignities be extended to them as full citizens. Yet here, food is transformed into an object to defile and degrade and to deny our shared humanity. Much has changed since those early days of civil protest. Young people move more or less freely in the consumer realm. Access to fast food and speedy service, a hallmark of America's modern age, is given without rebuke, with some exception, of course. Processed food is inexpensive, even in our nation's poorest communities. Young people, irrespective of race, represent billions in revenue for food and beverage industries. And fast food is a key mediator of youth cultural production, as this clip that I'm going to show will illustrate.
Larry Hoover, whipping work. Hallelujah. One nation under God. Real.
I'm kind of new to the menu, so you gotta give me a minute.
Take your time to throw it on whenever you're ready.
Alright. Wait a sec, can you give me a minute? Because I'm new to the menu and wondering if I should get it. Yeah, I do. It's an order for two. I want 12 roast beef and a beef adjudicate. I hope I stay in shape and I don't get fat. You know what? Who cares? I'd have fried to that. A drink, a shake, and a junior deluxe. Wait, homie, will that give you upper reflux?
Yeah.
Okay, never mind. I have a water instead. That should go to quicker order. The end.
That was all freestyle.
Hey, I'm sorry, I lost you at 12
years. Do you guys have chocolate milk?
No, we don't.
Oh, really? Can I get one of those chocolate junior shakes?
The chocolate shakes, okay?
Yeah, and that'll do it.
Okay, so this is one of the many videos that went viral. They get posted to YouTube. This is the Arby's freestyle or the Arby's rap. There's McDonald's. There's ones for Starbucks, for Chick-fil-A, and so on. And these have been, I think since about 2006, young folks have been posting these to YouTube. Okay. So overcoming exclusion from the consumer realm alone is no longer the yardstick of freedom or equality. So what does it mean? Well, in a context where access is extended more or less to all, we can certainly find instead an alternate scheme for sorting groups and assigning value based on how we consume and what we consume. To the increasingly health-conscious and educated folks in Northern Virginia and Washington, D.C., McDonald's, for instance, represents a kind of stigmatized consumption, poor food for poor folks. Rejecting McDonald's was an important marker of class identity for many of the middle-class youth I interviewed. It was eaten only as a last resort and was seen as having questionable quality. As one girl tells me, I mean, we have McDonald's and Burger King, but we never go there. I'm used to eating like healthier things, I guess, offered another. I mean, McDonald's and Wendy's, I can't imagine the last time I've eaten anything from there. Sushi and Panera salad will sound more appealing. Health talk, concern about healthy bodies is often difficult to disentangle from a set of aesthetic concerns for folks belonging to the middle class. When McDonald's opened its first store over two decades ago in France, French officials expected it to fail, seeing it largely as a menace of Americanization and cheap commercialism. But it was a hit, well, at least among French adolescents. Its success rested on the freedom from adult supervision that self-service, a hallmark of fast food, provided, and because the aesthetic it projected was an alternate to the stuffy French restaurants. In the four McDonald's that I observed after school, all McDonald's, not incidentally, located directly across the street from high schools, participation was uneven. In one school, the McDonald's was occupied almost entirely by footballers and basketballers bused in from the low-income portion of the county before going off to practice. At the McDonald's across the street from Washington, one of the other schools that I observed, which is in a school district where the median home price is $630,000, the base of customers were largely elderly Asian and South American immigrants, not kids. But kids could be found scattered at Starbucks, Elevation Burger, and Chipotle. So there are a few points here. So the first point is to look at food is to look at how social inequalities pattern its consumption. The second point, when we think about eating, we tend to think in terms of individual and individual preferences. I don't like broccoli, I like jelly beans, as past presidents have declared. As a sociologist, I confess to being much more interested in how food consumption comes into being through collective activities, focusing on the dynamic meaning of food and decentering the individual food consumer. Policy work and practical interventions to increase access to and consumption of healthy foods have not focused enough on the collective meaning formed around food. So how is meaning of food formed? Certainly, consumer markets play an undeniable role. When I first began this project in 2008, my daughter, who was at the time 7, and I were watching TV, and a Subway commercial came on, clearly marketed to preteens, called The Power to Choose. The commercial begins with a voiceover of a well-known preteen actress. Everything's decided for me, when to get up, what to wear, what to read, and of course, when to go to bed. As the commercial runs, we're presented with a series of images of the girl struggling to get out of bed, her mother's reproach for her punk-inspired outfit, doing homework in her bedroom. In the commercial's final scene, the girl stands at the Subway counter, poised to place her order, as she proudly declares, "But at Subway, I have the power to choose, and I eat it up." At the commercial's end, my daughter leapt from the floor, declaring, "I want to go to Subway." Indeed, marketers from food and beverage industries have been hugely successful at aligning consumption of 7-Up, Lucky Charms, Cheetos, Capri Sun with particular social meanings that are resonant with young people: empowerment, freedom, irony, irreverence. But meaning is also generated in daily life. Young people's food lives are totally immersed in the commercial realm. Interviews with young folks testify to this. Young people eat at a truly staggering number of meals out. Food is largely sorted in terms of brand. Subway is regarded as healthy, Burger King, not healthy. This is a fact that is both astounding and unremarkable. So what does food do for young people? What's its symbolic importance? Yes, it fills us up when we're hungry. The salty French fries at McDonald's really do taste good, but it does more. Consider this excerpt from my field notes at Baskin-Robbins, where I observed 3 girls, all obvious French, slouched comfortably in their seats as they share in a large ice cream sundae. Their talk full of laughter, their giggles interjected between words as each clamors to speak over the other in fits and starts, all the while eating this single sundae. I hear one say, "I'm so full, I'm so full," and another chimes in, "Oh my God, look at my stomach." A moment later, the same round of comments are offered again. "I'm so full, seriously, look at my stomach, it's bigger." Laughter bursting from the group, spilling over to where I sit. Just then, one of the girls lets out a resounding burp. It echoes, and she immediately giggles, looks at me, and then remarks that people think she's a trucker. They laugh at the apparent contradiction and their talk resumes. It's hard to miss the obvious pleasure these girls experience, reveling in this moment, a cosmic bubbling up of girl energy, as they play with the gender boundaries and feminine scripts that guide girls to adulthood, but also rein them in. The ice cream's value is as conversational and symbolic resource. It helps to constitute them as a friendship group. It transforms this ordinary encounter into play and enables them to lay claim to this public space. Which gets me to my third point. Any focus on young people and food has to pay attention to the cultural logic of food. That is, what it communicates. What meaning does it hold, for whom, and in what setting? The appeal of eating junk food can certainly be explained by the fact that it's rich in salt, sugar, and fat, and it's heavily marketed. But it's also a means to solidify young people's identity against adults, bound up with belonging and membership in age-based groups. Eating bad food on the fly is what you do during final exams. Like all-nighters, it's recounted to friends as evidence of student suffering, sacrifice, and dedication to studies. Food, full of meaning, is also about love, the strength of durable bonds, family identities, ethnic identification, national belonging. It's a resource for the self. Adolescent girls in the Victorian era, for example, used food refusal as a means to exercise control and manage sexual meaning tied to the female body and respectability. For young women who are involved in the pro-Anna movement, a mostly online community forum in support of an anorexic lifestyle, the denial of food is a moral claim about the strength of resolve and the exercise of restraint, high premium cultural values. However, from a number of the young women I interviewed who carefully distanced themselves from the adolescent girl who worries obsessively over food and her weight because that girl is a poster child for low self-esteem and powerlessness and is too concerned about the evaluation of others, I often heard bold declarations. I eat. I like food. Food is good. One girl, when I asked what her favorite food was, laughed and replied, "Food is my favorite." Famed anthropologist Mary Douglas once described eating as a field of action. And what is clear is it's a highly contested field. Contradictory forces of change at the macro level have reorganized food in the last century. Much has been written about the rise of the industrial diet, industrial agriculture, what many regard as a fundamentally broken and unsustainable food system with its negative impact on health, the poor, and the environment. That is important, though a too narrow focus on macro processes alone misses the meaning-making that both inspires and constrains action. If we want to affect positive change, reverse diet-related health outcomes, an important piece of the puzzle is understanding the quotidian aspects of young people's lives as they move through lunch lines in the cafeteria, order a number two at McDonald's, and eat their reheated dinner alone in front of the television as they complete the last leg of their homework after returning home from basketball practice. That is the food landscape they occupy. So I'd like to talk about food meaning in school, which we might consider the public provisioning of food, and then food meaning at home, which is the private provisioning of food. But before I do, let me just tell you a little bit about how I collected the data. I'm an ethnographer, and I had the help of four very capable graduate students with my data, this data collection from the sociology program. I observed two public high school cafeterias, both in Virginia, Thurgood and Washington High School, both are pseudonyms. At Thurgood High School, 60% of the students were on free or subsidized lunch, which is important to note because this is a proxy for socioeconomic status. Less than 8% of students at Washington were. Recall the $630,000 price tag for a home in that school district. I did visit a third private school a few times. Because they didn't have a working kitchen, lunch was brought in twice weekly by mothers in the PTA from commercial outlets like Chick-fil-A, Honey Baked Hams, and Domino's Pizza. This is an interesting contrast to the early days of the National School Lunch Program, which was also run by the PTA, but with home-cooked meals. I observed fast food settings at the end of the school day, which were located near schools, Subway, Baskin-Robbins, Dairy Queen, McDonald's, Chipotle, Starbucks, Baja Fresh. I conducted interviews and focus groups with just under 60 young folks ages 15 to 23 who came from different economic and family situations, racial and ethnic groups. Some were in high school, some were at community colleges, and some were in four-year schools. And I collected 220 family food memories written by college students who were under the age of 23. Finally, I worked last year as an external program evaluator, examining the DC's Farm-to-School Network and the Arcadia Center for Sustainable Food and Agriculture, which is located in Fairfax County. Arcadia is a nonprofit working to implement food reforms in DC and Northern Virginia public schools to increase children's consumption of fruits and vegetables and their knowledge of food origins and to improve access to healthy, locally sourced fruits and vegetables for low-income, food insecure families, the bulk of whom depend on government benefits like SNAP, senior vouchers, and WIC, and usually live in areas where access to healthy, minimally processed food is low. I observed their farm-to-school programs, their monthly taste tests of locally seasonal foods in DC schools, their field trips on their farm at Woodlawn Estates, and their mobile farmers market, which operates out of a retrofitted bright green school bus, where they sell eggs and other lean proteins, fruits and vegetables, all locally sourced, and do food education on the global and local food system and provide cooking demonstrations. So a core aim for this project is to bring the tools of cultural analysis to bear on a topic that's captivated policy and grassroots interests. What kids eat increasingly occupies a morally charged sphere. Cultural brokers, parents, and advocates for junk food-free schools, members of food justice movements, public health researchers, the anti-hunger lobby, all adjudicate the meaning of youth food consumption. Youth food consumption is a sphere rather than a single activity. This is in large part because of the growing concern about childhood obesity. First Lady Michelle Obama's Let's Move campaign, spearheaded in 2008, was formed to tackle childhood obesity. Federal and local policy reforms, such as the 2010 DC Healthy Schools Act and the Healthy Hunger-Free Kids Act of 2010 have helped spur change in public schools. Different institutional actors, as they mobilize around childhood obesity, harness its power to their own ends. Military leaders have framed childhood obesity in terms of national security risk. Urban community health activists have seized childhood obesity as a means to confront food insecurity in their communities and work against the degradation of public space, including community parks and playgrounds. And marketers of children's snack foods have capitalized on childhood obesity to gain greater market share in the highly competitive food market. Currently, the CDC estimates that 1 in 3 American children are either overweight or obese, and that is much higher for children living in concentrated poverty. Confirming what we've long known, health disparities reflect wealth disparities. Almost 25% of children live in poverty in the US, and 1 in 6 Americans report being food insecure, which means that they struggle to feed their families one or two times during the week. Right? In Washington, 1/3 of children live in poverty, 3/4 qualify for free or subsidized lunch, and 85% of high school students don't receive the minimum daily requirements of 5 vegetables and fruits a day. We should be paying attention. In the debates over who is responsible for childhood obesity, schools have received their fair share of criticism, especially as public awareness has grown about the influence of food and beverage industries, the expansion of commercial profit, sometimes at the expense of children's nutrition, eroding resources for the National School Lunch Program, and the abundance of French fries and nachos, what nutritionists call energy-dense, nutrition-poor foods. Public records reveal that food and beverage industries spent $175 million between 2009 and 2011 to lobby against tougher nutritional standards for food marketed to children, to ensure that exercise drinks could remain in school even if soda can't, and to guarantee that French fries could remain on the menu in public schools as a vegetable in the reimbursable meal. Bearing in mind that most public schools have no allotted school budgets apart from the reimbursement from their National School Lunch Program, that food directors are reliant on what's called competitive foods, and these are the revenue-driven foods, ice cream, sandwiches, Pop-Tarts, Rice Krispie Treats, to break even, and that vending machines are a hugely important revenue source for schools. Today, school cafeterias are forced to compete against commercial outlets for students' money and loyalty, the latter of which they rarely get, especially if it's an open campus where kids can leave for lunch. While school food was at one point supposed to approximate home-cooked meals, today it's modeled after commercial foods. For all the young people I interviewed, irrespective of school, commercial counterparts were the primary reference in evaluating school lunch, whether talking about burritos, chicken nuggets, Chinese food, or pizza. How we got here is a long and complicated story about politics and market forces, federal government's effort to stabilize agricultural markets, to assimilate new immigrant populations, to reduce poverty-related malnutrition. What's important to know is that the National School Lunch Program, a program that was once conceived to feed all of our nation's children, although it never did, in the late 70s and the 80s converted to a program of poor food for poor kids. Many of you will recall the ketchup as vegetable debacle of the 1980s. As federal dollars for school lunch waned, so did student participation, particularly among middle-class kids, since their lunch would no longer be substantially subsidized, which meant a loss in revenue. Lunch spiraled downward in terms of appeal and nutrition, which leads us to where we are today. School lunch, easy fodder. Students' complaints about school food are legion. Many, many kids interviewed complained about school food. In fact, if you go up on Facebook, you will find many groups dedicated to how much school lunch sucks. That's their word, not mine. The prevailing assumption in many camps is that to make food appealing to kids requires a forfeit of health, that kids will refuse the healthy offerings, generating enormous plate waste, is a questionable claim. Sure, there are kids content to eat pizza day in, day out, but they don't represent the diversity of viewpoints held by young people. A recent study from UC Berkeley's Center for Weight and Health found that a majority of high schoolers, 69%, surveyed thought having fresh fruit on the menu more important than chips, candy, and soda. Quite the opposite of what we think about teenagers' preferences. Let me give you an example from my work as program evaluator for Arcadia. When I went with Arcadia's food educator to do monthly taste tests in DC public schools, in this instance, the featured item was rockin' red radish salsa, which the kids loved. At one of the schools we visited where 99% of the kids are free and reduced lunch, I was surprised to see trays in the garbage with only traces of food, very little plate waste, for a lunch of orange slices, corn, black beans, locally sourced ground beef. This is a school that works with food provider DC Central Kitchen, doing on-site scratch cooking, and they've taken advantage of the DC's Healthy Schools Act provision to use locally sourced foods for extra reimbursement. As I said earlier, we need to pay attention to what food communicates, its cultural logic. In that setting, food was bundled up with caretaking, an ethos of community care. As kids ate their lunch, the food service workers warmly and lovingly explained the food to the kids as they moved through the lunch line. I watched Chef Sarah come out from the kitchen, talk to the kids about food, asking them what they thought about it, and as she moved from table to table. And another woman showed me how she carefully arranged food items on their mobile salad bar, her homemade croutons, and how she made sure to put the vegetables in front because the kids were more likely to take them that way. This is not about the delivery of random food in a bureaucratic institutional setting. In truth, there is tremendous range in how school lunch is organized. It's probably no accident that the two high schools that let me come to observe their school, their cafeterias were schools that they thought they had something to be proud of. I think it would have been difficult for me to gain access to schools where the lunch was not very good. Thurgood, the school with 60% free and reduced lunch, was an interesting school to observe. For one, the school used to be an open campus. Kids could leave for lunch. When they were in their old school building, the cafeteria wasn't large enough to accommodate all the students, so kids were farmed out to McDonald's and other places nearby. What this meant is that kids with disposable income ate out, and the cafeteria was a space where the low-income kids ate. When they built the new school a few years ago, they closed the campus and decided to conduct student-led focus groups and student-generated surveys to find out what kids wanted in a cafeteria. And what they found is that kids wanted a cafeteria that didn't feel like school. Indeed, it doesn't. The cafeteria looks like a food court in a mall. All food stations are modeled after their commercial equivalents. There is an impressive array of meal offerings, which, as the food director told me, are all lower in salt and sugar and fat than their commercial counterparts. And students are seen as consumers. But this was a way for the food director to get the lunch ladies to be nicer to the kids. And choice reigns. Choice is a convoluted concept. It's mediated by market ideas about consumer choice on the one hand, but it's also part of a broader discourse and modern attitudes about children's rights. Certainly, this cafeteria is an example of how commercial markets serve as templates for a range of social institutions. But for the food director, the stakes were really high. On the one hand, the food director had to work diligently to maximize what's called ADP, average daily participation, lest the cafeteria revert back to what it once was, a place for poor kids to eat. So she sold sushi at $5 a pop, which was one of the competitive foods. On the other hand, the food director was deeply motivated by concerns that if the kids didn't have a range of food offerings, they would be either left without food, there was widespread acknowledgement that some of the kids' only meals were at school, or they would reject the food and opt for other something else that had lower nutritional value. Again, an ethics of care seemed a primary motive, a means to address both hunger and health. In the interview, when I interviewed the food director, she remarked to me, "The first kids that ever got to come into the cafeteria, I'll never forget those kids. They came through and they said, wow, they thought that much of us to make this building." The food director referred to the new cafeteria as the great equalizer, a space where students across differences sat side by side. In truth, there was a lot of division and segregation in the cafeteria. Some kids brought lunch from home to stay above the fray and to opt out of the scene altogether. Yet I heard very few complaints about the food from students. The single most common complaint was long, crowded lines, whereas interviews from students who had attended other schools, boredom of the menu was a central concern. Boredom with food in school isn't surprising, since in the commercial realm, choice is endless. Over time, I began to see the school was running a campaign to communicate their investment in kids and to increase student investment and sense of belonging in school through the cafeteria and its food offerings, and mostly for a group of kids who were otherwise disengaged from school, at least its academic spaces. The cafeteria was an important point of contact. I observed lots of interactions between the dean of students and the kids who I suspect spend as much time in the cafeteria as in the classroom. This was especially meaningful because the school was working to address and was under considerable pressure to narrow a pretty significant achievement gap between low-income kids, many of them who were of color, and higher-income kids who were overwhelmingly white. This played out around food in other ways. So the administration had wanted to allow some of the kids to be able to leave campus for lunch, but they were aware that if they used GPA as the basis, like most other schools do, that it would look as though that they were favoring one group of kids over another. School lunch at Thurgood was seen as a way to resolve some enduring inequalities that beckoned outside the school door. But it was also a space that recreated inequalities too, or at least the school space was a space where inequalities were created. Washington, the other school I studied, was very different, and at the end I can answer some questions about that, but I'm going to move on to talk about families. School food reflects our cultural ambivalence about the public provisioning of food, something we largely associate with the private realm of home, motherly care, the durable bonds of family. Whereas school food assumes a sort of mythic status as gross, home-cooked food is locked in what historian Stephanie Kuntz has termed the nostalgia trap. Young people's increased obligation outside the home, combined with parental work demands and the cult of busyness for all, impinge on the collective act of eating. As one girl explained, I'm a three-sports athlete, so a lot of time after school, I go to like Subway or McDonald's or Starbucks. Changing work-family patterns, the movement of large number of women into the workforce, the geographical dispersal of families with extended kin spread out, the increase in single mothers, the rise of industrial agriculture, the outsourcing of food preparation to commercial markets, all shape the family meal. Speed and preparation ease are overwhelmingly rated as top considerations in food selection for families. And about half of all parents with children ages 12 to 17 report having dinner with their children daily, according to the US Census. And it's interesting because this is a practice that's more common among parents with less education, not more. Sociologists have long noted that the informal systems of kin care are fragile, more fragile and fragmented at a time where family life is actually more complex and more demanding. When families do eat together, they often do not eat the same thing, reflecting our deep commitments to the individual. It's in this context that food has declined in practical importance in families. As a 22-year-old full-time student with a full-time job and a 2-year-old son remarked to me, I do food on the cheap. But food has also been elevated in symbolic importance. So you'll note as I begin quoting the palpable sense of longing from these folks. I remember our family used to eat together at the table. When dinner used to be about family talk, now it's about TV or nothing at all. There were repeated references to busy schedules, schedules so packed. My parents were always busy and worked late. My parents' schedules are very demanding. We barely sat down together. Many noted changing rhythms within their own families. We used to live a somewhat parallel life to the Cleavers. But fathers lost jobs, mothers returned to work, new children arrived, parents divorced, mothers had aging parents to care for, children grew older and faced an expanding array of obligations outside the home. As one girl explained, we don't eat together. My mom used to, she would make dinner every single night, and now we have my stepdad and my stepbrothers, we're all so busy. Another, my family came to America as refugees from Somalia. It was difficult to adjust. We dealt with this by talking about it over dinner at night. Then things started to change. We eventually started to really like some of the American foods like pizza and hamburgers. Family talk and cultural food for dinner turned into pizza while watching MTV. Another wrote, we would rarely sit together at the table and eat because my father, sister, and I would get home at different times. Usually we would eat our food in front of the TV in three different rooms. The family meal, shared maybe once a week, emerges as a symbolic cultural anchor, idealized as a space to resolve conflict. So one person wrote, a safe haven from the rest of the week. Another wrote, Sunday dinner where everything gets fixed. Holiday meals were magnified moments, awash in the excess of love, family togetherness, and abundance of food. As one student wrote, food stretched beyond what the eye could see, family members packed in like sardines around a formal dining room table that for the remainder of the year is piled high with paper and boxes. Another, growing up, I was more or less on my own when it came to finding something to eat in my house. Really, the only time cooking was a must was Thanksgiving or Christmas. Historian Elizabeth Pleck explains that in the last century, holiday meals emerged as these sentimental domestic occasions, much like what we're hearing here, in reaction to deepening middle-class anxieties about industrial expansion. For these young people, holidays seemed to provide something daily meals didn't, a momentary glimpse of a strong family core, perhaps to hang their hopes for greater family connection or a collective identity to anchor the self. Unlike daily meals, where everyone fends for themselves, the collective trumps the individual. But memories are funny things because they are highly selective. Sometimes they are not even our own. Our cultural expectations of family and family time have intensified as have our expectations about what children need from their parents. Sociologists have found that based on time use diaries, that parents actually spend more time with their children today, not less, than they did in the 60s, though mothers spend less time cooking. Family changes over the life course. Children grow older and more independent, their outside activities increase, grandparents grow older and die. These life course changes are often made sense through a lens of cultural nostalgia for a largely fictional collective past, of family cohesion set against an assumption of fractured families of the present. What one historian referred to as the families we never were. Husband and wife sociologist the Lins, famous study from Middletown, which was based in Muncie, Indiana, and conducted in the 1920s, also noted that family members were pulled away from the family meal by outside activities. Food, as we imagine it, seems to promise unity and wholeness at a time where the self is pulled in various directions and family members, young and old, manage a changing set of obligations as they confront changes to public and private spheres of existence. So what's the takeaway from this snapshot? I've had three core points. To look at food is to look at how social inequalities pattern its consumption. When we think about eating, we need to think beyond the individual, focus on collective life, or maybe more accurately, the tension between cultural life and individualism. And we need to understand the cultural logic of food, what it communicates. The need to appreciate the meaning particular food holds for different groups was argued by the famous anthropologist Margaret Mead to the federal government in the 1940s in her work with the USDA. We derive meaning from our consumption, and consumption is deeply cultural in form. By that, I mean that as we consume food, we understand food from cultural categories already in play. Let me give a last example from my work as program evaluator at Arcadia. Part of liking a food is being able to understand the food and to fit it into an existing or familiar food type. This was most glaring during the taste tests with the elementary school kids in DC. Kids drew constant comparisons, statements like, "it tastes like," were ubiquitous. On this particular occasion, the item was strawberry gazpacho that they were trying. Students didn't like the strawberry gazpacho, not because it didn't taste good, but because they couldn't figure out how to decipher it. "It's nasty. It's nasty. It doesn't taste like strawberry," one boy declared. Another in despair, "doesn't smell right, doesn't taste right." Strawberries are supposed to be sweet, not spicy like gazpacho. This was compounded by the fact that the kids drank the soup rather than using a spoon. Because strawberry gazpacho didn't fit with existing food categories, many kids had difficulty integrating it into existing cognitive schema, which is social in form. That is, until they realized they could use it as a dip, like a salsa for their chips, or they could drink it as a smoothie. It wasn't soup anymore. Once children figured out how to eat it, they were more likely to express appreciation of it. In making an argument for why cultural analysis is important for policy and practice, I don't want to sidestep what are deeply etched inequalities in the structure of social life. They work together. Much larger problems are in play. Declining wages, eroding safety net, growing fragility of families create conditions for the demand for inexpensive, overly processed foods. For many communities, concern about obesity and other diet-related health problems are tied to the built environment, not just in terms of the number of grocery stores that are available, but the extent to which young people and their parents feel safe in their communities to utilize parks and other green spaces. Historically, redlining and lending practices led to uneven development in cities, giving rise to what we now recognize as ghettos. Financial disinvestment and capital devaluation in the urban core propelled neighborhoods into deep poverty with its declining access to healthy foods. Observations from Washington and Thurgood, the high schools I studied, reveal that a widening food gap between the haves and the have-nots is not simply about improving access to healthy foods for low-income families and children, but also addressing the scaling up of food expectations and entitlements for higher-income kids. Some of you may recall when Obama announced that his kids, his girls, would attend the elite Sidwell Friends, much was made of their menu. Fennel and arugula salad, organic pear and gorgonzola salad, grilled portobello mushrooms. How's that for school lunch? Young people's food consumption belongs to an economic terrain, but also a moral one. And for many, it belongs also to a realm of rights. The Youth Food Bill of Rights, drafted by the nonprofit RIC, which is rooted in community, at their Youth Congress articulates as a basic right, the right to real food. During RIC's annual Youth Summit, teenagers build networks to transform the food system and participate in dignity dialogues. The UN Convention of the Rights of the Child states, state parties recognize the right of the child to the enjoyment of the highest attainable standards of health. State parties shall pursue full implementation of this right and in particular shall take appropriate measures to combat disease and malnutrition through the provision of adequate nutritious foods, to ensure that all segments of society, in particular parents and children, are informed, have access to education, and are supported in the use of basic knowledge of children's health and nutrition. Food movements have gained a lot of traction in the last decades, addressing health disparities, environmental injustice, helping to shift how we think about food. There are many successful programs in the U.S. based on collaborative community partnerships. Harvest for Healthy Kids, a partnership with Portland State University, promotes healthy eating and for kids and supports a local food system. As we move forward, greater attention needs to be given to how teens and young adults can become more involved in enacting food reforms that impact them. Without a doubt, the overwhelming focus on food reforms targeting young people have been directed at elementary school age kids. For many adults, the sense that the battle has already been lost with teens, that impact would be minimal, was something that I heard too often. There was a palpable sense of frustration and resignation by many folks. Yet social justice work with teens and young adults have had impact. Summer Solutions, based at the Hartford Health Justice Program in Connecticut, organizes youth gardens. Young folks transform empty urban spaces, injecting life into a setting long neglected. That provides a good example. Food reforms in school must be accompanied by curricular changes to shift food consciousness in order to offset resistance. We know that without a focus on food education, kids will reject the food. Sociologist Cynic Elliott, whose work she's been interviewing low-income mothers in North Carolina, and what she's found, and looking at these food changes that they're implementing there, is that the kids don't necessarily have any nutritional education. And in one case, one of the mothers whose son was qualified for free and reduced lunch refused to eat the healthy options. And so she was now packing his lunch, right? I would recommend in a focus on nutritional education, moving beyond conventional nutritional education to a focus on food literacy. What is a broader curricular project that enables students to engage a wide range of concerns relating to food and diet, health, environment and sustainability, industrial food production and food origins, community empowerment and public space. A critical food literacy program, in contrast to nutritional education, is expansive in scope, builds on school, nonprofit, and community partnerships, and advances a critical approach to teaching where learning is student-centered. Arcadia's farm-to-school lessons in the global and local food system, with its focus on how food gets to DC, aim to transform an abstract system into a set of concrete exchanges with role-playing and a rope as a food web. And that provides a good example of critical food literacy. Critical food literacy is especially important since young people's struggles for autonomy and claims of cultural authority are often sought in the consumer realm. Recall the video from earlier in the talk. One of the community organizers that I interviewed from DC Ward 7 ran a program aimed to turn youth into critical consumers. She taught them how to interrogate claims by taking them to the grocery store to read labels, look at sodium content, to deconstruct the difference between better for you and good for you, to unpack healthy and natural claims. Food reforms also need to deal with what the cafeteria signifies for kids. If a reprieve from the assault on the self occurring in academic spaces, right, if that's the only space in school that's meaningful to them, this will have consequences for how young people respond to food changes. What are the broader conceptions of schooling in play? Food service workers are also an untapped resource in promoting healthy eating practices and communicating knowledge about a food's value and origins. They are rarely considered stakeholders, and their work has largely been de-skilled. Yet, there were several instances in the data collection that I conducted where food service workers were attempting to promote healthy eating, providing care beyond the mere delivery of food to their students. Researchers at Yale's Rudd Center for Food Policy and Obesity call this nudging, and they found that verbal prompts from food service workers to children matter. With additional training, food service workers' potential for impact is real. The reason why? Because trust and relationships of care and connection are important components of children consuming and appreciating foods. The relationship Arcadia's food educator forged with the kids at the school where he conducted taste tests each month had significant impact on their willingness to try their foods, even the strawberry gazpacho. I worry sometimes that we rely too heavily on the extraordinary efforts of a few as we work to create change. The football coach at Thurgood, for example, fed his players before game practice. And these were players who were mostly low income, cooking himself to keep their stomachs full and to minimize their reliance on fast food options. At another school, no such effort was made, and so the kids ate at the McDonald's before practice and games, despite a mandate from the coach that McDonald's was off limits on game day. Food bans like these tend to come up against a fierce libertarian streak on the one hand, and on the other, because they're top-down, they serve to foreclose the type of meaningful dialogue needed for teenagers to see why they should pay attention. I think we also need to be cautious as we respond to what can sound like pretty alarmist rhetoric around childhood obesity as an epidemic. Campaigns to reverse obesity trends among the young, in some quarters, look more like crusades against fat, giving rise to what anthropologist Greenhall has termed bio-bullying, where overweight kids are the subject of increasing scrutiny. We have fixed our anxieties to the obese child, but we must ask where we fix our anxieties and what function it serves us. Some scholars have noted that we tend to collapse thin and healthy because of our anti-fat bias. Others note the low and arbitrary definitions of overweight and obese, while others have taken note of the changes in measurement, the BMI thresholds changing in 1998, propelling a much larger number of folks into the category of overweight than the day before. Yet I remain hopeful because of the good work of lots of organizations, a steady funding stream from USDA for grants for innovative and local efforts and partnerships to improve access, food literacy, a reskilling of food workers, and improvements of equipment in school kitchens. I do hope we give more attention to the importance of meaning and how it works. Arcadia got its programs right because they understood that meaning is important to action. The mobile farmers market that they run understood that they needed to undertake a major community outreach, build partnerships with local organizations that were seen to represent the interests of community members in order to secure trust and build demand. They understood that the experience of shopping for low-income folks is often without respect and dignity, and sought to counter that by creating a space where reciprocity and exchange of knowledge could occur. As they provided food demonstrations, they welcomed stories from customers, many with not so distant agricultural pasts. They recognized that many of these folks were already critical of the current food landscape, and that they themselves were critical partners. There's so much hope in food, which is probably one of the reasons why it's receiving the attention it is as a locus of change. Let us not forget all the things that go with it. More than anything else, meaning matters. Youth food consumption is a sphere of meaning rather than a single set of acts. It's comprised of a bundle of actors and institutions at work. So much remains unaddressed, and I will open for questions now. Thank you very much.